All right, this lecture is called Om Sweet Om, and its quote is "Resistance is futile" from Jean-Luc Picard. So now what we're going to do is we're going to take a look, and this lecture is going to introduce you to the idea of resistance and then the relationship between voltage, current, and resistance, known as Ohm's Law. So the learning goals are, number one, that you understand the factors that affect the resistance of a wire, that you be able to calculate the resistance of a wire, that you understand why voltage, current, and resistance are related, and that you also be able to calculate any of the above using Ohm's Law. So what we already knew. We knew voltage is the push that moves a charge through a wire. We know that current is the rate of charge flowing through the wire. And we know that voltage is not dangerous, but current is, and that they're related. So that's what we already knew based on labs and previous lecture. What we learned in the lab this time is that they are directly related. If you double the voltage, you double the current. And we did that by hooking up a circuit, increasing the voltage, and we saw an increase in the current as well. So what does that tell us? Well, it tells us that there are electrical devices that slow down or stop the flow of charge, and we call those things resistors. Devices that slow down the charge a lot are really called resistors. Charges that are devices that do not slow down charges very much are called conductors. These are all examples of different resistors. Now, the color codings mean there is a system for understanding what the resistance is based on the color. Now, you're not going to have to learn the color codes for this particular class, but it is a good idea to know what they are if you're planning on doing electrical work. So, resistors. Resistors use the electricity. We've talked about this already. They use the electricity by doing work on the charge, and then therefore it creates light, it creates heat, it does something that uses that energy. And so you see all these things are examples of resistors. Conductors and insulators. So the reason why conductors conduct electricity is they have a very loose hold on their valence electrons. In fact, most of them have what is called the d orbital. If you remember this stuff from chemistry, the d orbital is delocalized and it allows the electrons to easily move back and forth. A lot of times they call it a sea of electrons. Insulators, on the other hand, have a much tighter hold on their valence electrons. So electrons can't just easily move through them because they have a grip on what's theirs. So because of that, you have this idea that conductors and insulators differ at the atomic level. Now, which elements are most likely to be electrical conductors? Well, you know that if you stick a fork in an electrical socket, you're going to get yourself hurt, and that's copper. Same thing if you did it with gold. Same thing if you did it with silver. Same thing if you did it with a couple of other metals, like maybe even zinc a little bit. Aluminum, yeah. So if you look, all of these metals that you're looking at tend to be in this range right here. And this right here is called the d orbital transition. Usually it's called transition metals, is what it's called. Okay, so you have this idea of transition metals, but that's where all the electrical conductors come from. So, how is resistance like a highway? Well, resistance is really traffic. Okay, so when you have a high resistance, what you're doing is you're slowing the flow of electrons as it goes through. Or, like traffic, slowing the flow of cars as they go down. There's a couple of things that can affect traffic. The length of the road. If you have a really long road and nobody can get off of it, there's more likely to be traffic there. If you have the composition of the road matters. So if it's a dirt road versus a gravel road versus an asphalt road versus a concrete road, the composition of the road will determine how fast a car can go on it. You can't have a car go 120 miles an hour on a dirt road because the car's just not going to make it. Okay, but on a concrete road, maybe. And then finally you have the lanes of traffic. The lanes of traffic are how many different options a car has to go where it wants to go. So because of that, you can relate all of these things. Length of the road is length of a wire. Road composition is wire composition. And finally, the number of lanes of traffic equals the area that you have for the electron to move through. So you have this idea of the highway analogy that allows you to figure out what the relationship is between those. There are other types of conductors that we'll talk about, and the first one is called a superconductor. A superconductor is a substance that has a resistance of basically zero. Okay, it's right around zero is really what it is. Okay, and what that means is that there is no loss of energy due to friction. So if you put 120 volts in, you get 120 volts on the other side because there is no loss of energy. Okay, one of the problems with superconductors now is that they have to be very, very, very cold, almost absolute zero, which is zero Kelvin. So until you can get a room temperature or just higher temperature superconductor, they're not realistic. But you also have this idea of semiconductors. And semiconductors are conductors that are resistors or conductors depending on their temperature. So as the temperature changes, so does the resistance. And this is the basis of all modern electronics. Everything that uses a transistor is going to use this idea of the semiconductor. All right, so it says a student is conducting an experiment that requires the delivery of voltage with as little resistance as possible. So little resistance. Design a wire that does this that will accomplish the goals of their investigation. So if you were to look at it, you have resistance. If you were to increase the length of the wire, you're increasing the resistance because it takes longer for it to go. If you were to change the composition of the road to something that is very smooth and therefore allows you to travel very fast, that right there would allow you to have less resistance. So it depends on what you want to do. In this case, I want to have as little resistance as possible. So I run a really short wire. Okay? I want a really short wire. I want a wire that's going to be made out of metal. And you can choose. You can choose gold, silver, copper, aluminum, whatever you want to choose. One of those things that's made out of one of those metals that we talked about. And finally, you want a wire that's really wide, okay, that has a large surface area. So you want a short, wide wire that's made out of gold or silver or copper or some sort of other metal that's a conductor. That's what you want to do to have as little resistance as possible. So this is the extension. So we're adding this in. This is the formula that actually allows you to calculate the resistance. And so you have this value right here. This R term is the resistance. And the resistance is what impedes, or what the ratio is of voltage to current. Really what it is how much it's slowing it down. Resistance is measured in the unit of the ohm, which is the Greek letter omega. So anytime you see the Greek letter omega, what you're looking for is that right there represents the resistance. This L term right here is the length of the wire. This A term is the area of the wire. And we talked about those terms and they're pretty self-explanatory. This term right here is called the resistivity. Not to be confused with the resistance, but the resistivity. Sometimes they call it the conductivity, but we're going to use the term resistivity. And what that is that's the factor that determines, that's based on what the material is made out of. If it's made out of glass, it's of super high value because glass is not a very good resistor. You increase this, resistance increases. If it's something like silver, silver has a super low resistivity, therefore it would have a very low resistance. You want to make conductors out of things that have a low resistivity. You want to make insulators out of things that have a high resistivity. So now, let's look at this example. It says a thin wire can be pulled by pulling a thicker wire through a small opening. This right here leaves the total volume the same while reducing the diameter of the wire. A wire of length L is increased to a length of 4L. What happens to the resistance of the wire? So this one right here can be kind of confusing for some people because they're like, I don't even know where to start. But the trick to this particular question is to start with the idea that the volumes are the same. Okay. So if you have an expression that says that the two volumes are the same, you can say V1 equals V2. Okay. Another way of expressing that in terms of variables that I want to look at would be that L1 A1 length times area equals L2 A2. Those two things have to equal for this particular circumstance. Okay, if they didn't, you'd be adding some volume somewhere that you don't have accounted for. So now what you would do is you would say, okay, now that I know these two things are the case, I can generate an expression. It says that the wire of length L is increased to 4L. So instead of saying L2, I can say it's 4L1. And that equals L1, A1. So if you were to look at this, the only way that this would work is that if A2 was the area of 1 divided by 4. That's the only way you can get these two things back to being equal. So what I can say is I can say that L2 is 4L1, and I can say that A2 is A1 over 4. So now that I've done that, I can examine the resistance of the wire. So for the first wire, you have the idea that R equals PL over A, and you plug in 1 for everything. So P1, or excuse me, P L1 over A1. So now for the second one, what I'm going to have is I plug in everything into the equation, but instead of plugging the other stuff in, I'm going to plug in P 4L1 and then A1 divided by 4. So remember, this expression right here represents the original resistance value. And now what I can do is I can rearrange this mathematically so that it works for me. I'm going to multiply both sides by 4 over, or excuse me, by 4 over 4. 4 over 4 is 1. It doesn't change the value of the expression, and it cancels this term out. So what I'm left with at that point is I have P 16L1 over nothing, or excuse me, over A1. Now remember, this P A1 L1 represents R. So really what I've done is I've increased the resistance to 16 times what the original resistance value was. So by pulling this wire and making it longer, 4 times longer, I've also made it 4 times thinner, and therefore I've increased the resistance by a factor of 16. This is a 10-gram wire, has a density of 5 grams per centimeter cubed. The wire has a total resistance of 10 ohms. The resistivity of the wire is 10 ohm meters. And we want to know what the length of this particular wire is. So we're trying to solve for the length. So now, the first thing we want to do is we start off with the idea of density. Density equals mass divided by volume. Or in our case, it's going to be 5 grams per centimeter cubed equals 10 grams divided by the volume. You rearrange, you get the volume is equal to 2 centimeters cubed. And you say, well, how is that particularly useful to me? Well, now that you have this, you can now say that the volume is equal to the length times the area. But I have a number for this now. I can say that 2 is equal to LA. Or I can say that area is equal to 2 over L. Now I can use the expression R equals PL over A. Okay? So I have the expression for L. That's what I'm trying to solve for. So I can plug in my values. I can say 10 equals 1.72 times 10 to the negative eighth. I can't plug anything in for L, but I can plug in 2 over L for the area. I'm going to multiply both sides by L over L, and when I do that, this cancels and this cancels, and what I'm left with is now L squared. I distributed that. So now I would take 10 divided by 1.72 times 10 to the minus eighth, divided by 2, and then I would take the square root, and what that means is that the length of the wire has to be about 34,100 meters. So you're talking about an extremely small, excuse me, long and very narrow wire in order to get 10 ohms of resistance out of just a 10-gram wire. The last one says, determine the resistance of a copper wire, tells you that, has a diameter of this and is 2.8 meters long. So once again, we're trying to use the equation R equals PL over A. So you have this idea that you have the resistance is what you're trying to solve for. P is 1.72 times 10 to the minus eighth. Remember, that depends on the material it's made out of. And then you have the length is 2.8. Now this right here is the diameter. So you assume that you have a cylindrical shape whenever you have a wire. So if you have a diameter of 1.5 centimeters, realize that that means that the radius is 0.75 centimeters. We would need to divide that by 100 to get it into meters. So we get 7.5 times 10 to the minus third. Okay, that right there is the radius. If we assumed it was cylindrical, you can now solve for the area of the circle as pi r squared, now that you have your r value. Okay, once you do this, you plug it in, and you get your area. Once you get your area, you would plug it in with everything else into the equation. As you plug them into the equation, you should get a final answer of about 2.73 times 10 to the minus 4th ohms. Make sure that you can get this answer before you come to class or come to class with questions. C4 says, which graph best represents the data? If you were to look, we're looking at the relationship between length and resistance. Those are governed in the equation R equals PL over A. Now remember, when we're looking at a graph, everything else is held constant and therefore goes away. So we have this idea right here where we have R equals L. We substitute in Y for R, we substitute in L for X, and we get a graph of Y equals X. The best answer that we have for that one is this one. Now we want to look at the relationship between voltage, current, and resistance, now that we know what resistance is, what current is, and what voltage is. We generated a graph in the lab that said you've got this relationship between voltage and current. Now you have to be careful when you look at these graphs, because sometimes you'll have voltage here and current here, or sometimes you'll have those reversed depending on the circumstances. But what you see here is that there's a constant steady increase. As I increase the voltage, I increase the current in an equal proportion. And that's showing you the relationship between voltage and current, and resistance right here is equal to Y, the graph is this particular slope. So let's take a look at it. You have what's called Ohm's law. This is the most commonly used formula in all of electricity. Okay, it shows the relationship between voltage, current, and resistance. We have talked about all of these variables individually. Now we just put them together. So, what is the potential, electric potential, required to move 5 moles of electrons down a wire per hour if a wire of this is 10 kilometers long with a diameter of this? So this starts off with a really, really difficult question. You have the idea of V equals IR. Okay, but in this case, I'm trying to solve for the voltage, and I'm given information on how to solve the current. And so what I need to do is I need to use this idea of Q over T to solve for the current so I can plug it in there. Then I need to use it for resistance. When I do resistance, it's going to be this PL over A term. And I need to solve for the resistance and then plug it in. So when I put these things together, what I'm trying to solve for, V, is going to equal to Q, not G, but Q, PL over AT. So that's what I got from this particular case. So let's take a look at this as we kind of work through this problem. It says you're required to move 5 moles of electrons down a wire. So I have the number of moles as 5 moles of electrons. And you should recognize the fact that you need to go from moles to charge. When you have 1 mole of electrons, that right there is 6.022. times 10 to the 23rd. This is similar to one of the extension examples in the previous questions. So that's how many electrons you have now. And you should know that one electron has a charge of 1.6 times 10 to the negative 19th coulombs. So when you multiply all this out, this allows you to calculate what the what the charge value is now, because we're going to find the charge. And so once you have the charge value, we calculate that to be, we'll take it into account whenever we look at the current overall. Okay, so now we have this idea right here of the time. It says per hour. So the time is going to equal to 3600 seconds. You should be able to convert between hours and seconds now. Then you also have the fact that you have the wire has a resistivity of 9.84 times 10 to the minus 7th ohm meters. And then you have a 10 kilometer long wire. So you have a 10 kilometer, which is 10,000 meters long wire. And then the last term is you have a diameter of 8. Now remember, you have a diameter of 8, and you're trying to solve for the area in this case. We're assuming it's circular. So we need to convert 8 to meters, and when you do that, you get 0.08 meters is the diameter. And remember, the area of a circle is calculated as pi r squared, where r represents the radius. So you would take 0.04, the area would equal to 0.04, which is r squared times pi. So this is a lot going on. This is trying to review everything, and what we've got is we've got this whole set of variables and we've got this equation right here. So now what I can do is I can plug into my calculator and I can solve for q, and I can plug it in. I can plug into my time. I can plug in my L value, and this can get kind of messy. I can plug in my P value, and then I can plug in my A value, and you can solve all those. So this is a good rehash of being able to do all the steps before this. When you do this, if you do it correctly, you should get a value of about 943,100 volts. Check yourself and make sure that you can get that. It's a little bit basic, more basic problem. This is the problem that's expected of you when you be able to do these, not the other one. The other one would be expected to be a mastery level or a bonus type question. So now we have a hairdryer that's rated at 120 volts that operates at 2.4 amps. Okay, so I can say V equals IR. I can say V is 120, I is 2.4, and I can solve for R. Now, when I do that, I would get 120 equals 2.4 R. Divide both sides by 2.4, and when I do that, I would actually get a resistance value of 50 ohms. Now, I'm taking this same resistor, and I'm plugging it into a 240-volt outlet. So I'm still using V equals IR, but now instead of 120 volts, I'm using 240 volts. So now when I plug it in, I'm solving for the current. And what I get is I get a current that is twice as high. Now, if you knew what you were doing, you didn't even have to do this. You could have recognized that you had the equation V equals IR, and that if you double the voltage, leaving this the same, then the current has to double as well because they are directly proportional. But it takes good practice to do it with the math as well. The next one says, what current does a 9-volt battery produce if the resistance is 6 ohms? So you have this idea of the voltage is 9 volts, you have the resistance value is 6 ohms, and you can solve for the current. The formula is V equals IR. You can say that 9 volts is equal to I times 6. Divide both sides by 6, and you get I is equal to 1.5 amps. Which one of these has the highest resistor value? So if you were to look at it, another word for potential difference is voltage. Another word for current is, you know, current. So now you have V divided by I. That would give you the slope in this case. Well, if you look at the formula V equals IR, when you divide both sides by I, you get V divided by I equals R. So R in this case is the slope. The one with the greatest slope is going to have the highest resistor value, which is this. If you're confused about this, this one is saying that as the voltage increases, the current does not. So that's an interesting thing. The only way that would happen would be with a higher resistance value.